This year, the Royal House of Windsor celebrates 100 years on the British throne. They are now the most famous royal family in the world and have prospered while other great dynasties have fallen. They've seen their relatives overthrown, murdered and exiled, overcome family feuds, fire and betrayal. And they have always followed one crucial rule: survive, whatever it takes, whatever the cost. The Windsors learned the dark art of survival in the days of war a century ago. They've never forgotten it. Now, Channel 4 can uncover their secrets with the help of family insiders, royal experts, and some of the most closely guarded papers in the world. We've combed through letters, diaries, government memos, confidential royal reports. And for the first time, cameras have been allowed into the Queen's personal family archives at Windsor. What we've found rips aside the mask of royal pomp to reveal the human frailties and the secrets of the family that built Britain's most powerful dynasty.
It is extremely difficult sometimes to keep a straight face when the Home Secretary said to me, there's a gorilla coming in. So I said, you know, what an extraordinary remark to make, very unkind about anybody. And so, you know, I stood in the middle of the room and pressed the bell and the doors opened. There was a gorilla. And I had the most terrible trouble in keeping, you know, he had short body, long arms. And I had the most appalling trouble.
On the 21st of June, 1969, an astonished British public saw something for the very first time. A fly-on-the-wall documentary showed a relaxed Queen telling stories around her dining room table.
The Royal Family documentary, more than any other moment, humanised the Royal Family. It meant that people saw them for the first time, really, as a family, like them. And it opened the doors to everything else that followed.
Overnight, the Windsors went from distant icons to familiar faces. It was the final victory in a 20-year battle to modernize the royal family. But the royal responsible wasn't born a Windsor at all. Prince Philip was an outsider, determined to drag the Windsors into the modern age.
There is this battle that is being fought behind the walls of the palace.
But Philip's impatient style led to hostility from the old guard.
The Queen Mother said he was a Hun. He was rough and overbearing.
Now, using documents never before seen by historians and revealing previously unknown meetings between senior royals, we tell the story of one man's controversial struggle to assert his authority and relaunch the royal family.
Stay as you are, or adapt and change, because if you don't, you die.
Twenty-two years earlier, the British public had been treated to a far more formal royal performance. The wedding of Princess Elizabeth to the newly created Duke of Edinburgh, Philip Mountbatten.
November the 20th, 1947, and London's background of misty grey became the setting of the greatest royal event the capital has seen since the coronation.
Born a Greek prince, the 26-year-old Philip was a war hero and decorated naval officer. Intelligent and driven, Philip was a natural leader. And although Elizabeth was next in line to the throne, for now, it was his career that came first. In October 1949, Philip was sent to the British naval base on Malta. There, he was promoted to lieutenant commander and took charge of his first ship, HMS Magpie.
Philip was always ambitious as a naval officer. He always had his eye on the main chance. He hoped to go right to the top of the Admiralty. He felt that this was his destiny.
Meanwhile, Philip's young wife was happy to take a back seat. Within a year of marriage, Princess Elizabeth had produced a male heir, Prince Charles, followed by a daughter, Princess Anne. That duty out of the way, she was free to enjoy the simple pleasures of life.
She could, for the first time, do more or less what she wanted. She could be like a normal young woman. She could go to the hairdresser on her own. She could drive around the island. She could go to the restaurants with her husband, go on picnics. And all the while, the Maltese people left them alone. And so Malta, for her, represented great sort of feeling of freedom.
But the couple's Maltese idyll was not to last. By February 1952, Elizabeth's father, George VI, was suffering from lung cancer. The young couple were asked to take over a royal tour to Australia and New Zealand, stopping en route in Kenya. One of the press corps on the trip was the 22-year-old photographer John Jochimson.
And one day, a chap of the East African Standard had got the news through from his paper that the king had died.
The heart of the nation stopped. The king is dead.
It had been released to the world, but it hadn't got to the queen. We went down to the lodge. This person came out and said, "Her Majesty requests that no pictures be taken." And in those days, unlike today with the paparazzi, we put our cameras down in the dirt and just stood there.
Aged just 25, Elizabeth was suddenly head of state to millions across the globe. From the first, she made plain that a new monarch did not mean a new style of reign.
I think it's very important for Elizabeth to follow the template which had been set down by her father. After all, he was the man who stabilized the monarchy after the abdication.
George VI's sober, traditional rule was a life raft to the Queen as she began her reign.
In my experience, so much of her thinking, particularly in her early years, is what her father did. So often she would say to me, "My father did it this way, my father told me that."
The Queen's desire to do things her father's way also stemmed from her own cautious nature.
There are stories about the Queen's childhood which suggest that she was a rather conservative character and somebody who very much valued order. And there are stories about her sort of keeping all her shoes very tidy. But the flip side to that is a character like that tends probably to be rather small-c conservative and like things to go on as they always have done.
The young Queen's husband was very different. Philip was restless and a born innovator. But with the King's death, the career he loved was suddenly in ruins. A friend said that when Philip heard the news, he looked absolutely flattened, as if the world had collapsed on him.
Although when he married the Princess Elizabeth, he must have known that this moment would come, he can't have expected it to come so soon.
He would have calculated, almost certainly, when they got married, that they would have had 20 years, at least, given George VI's relatively young age.
It really was, what, barely 4 years since the marriage? Now his naval career was over, and he was going to spend the rest of his life walking 4 paces behind his wife.
But the fiery Philip wouldn't remain silent for long. Just weeks after Elizabeth's accession, he would clash with the palace old guard and turn up the pressure on his own marriage.
Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II was on her way to the House of Lords to deliver her first speech from the throne.
In 1952, the royal couple began their new life. The young queen suddenly had huge responsibilities. But for her husband, it was a different story.
he had no function. In the Navy, you have a function. In his role in Buckingham Palace, it was very difficult to see precisely where he fitted in. Philip very much was an alpha male, a dominant male, and he resented the situation.
Philip had sacrificed his career ambitions for the sake of his wife. Yet there was one part of the marriage over which he was determined to retain control.
For any man at that time, it was terribly important to have certain emblems in your life that represented what you were on Earth. And one of them was that your wife would take your name, because that was the tradition at the time, and that your children would also have as their last name yours.
Yet Philip's determination to give the royal children his own name set the young outsider on a collision course with the older Windsor generation, led by his mother-in-law. The Queen Mother had been a power behind the throne during her husband's reign. Now, she was reluctant to leave Buckingham Palace, as a letter in the Royal Archives reveals.
I could be quite self-contained upstairs, meals, etc. You'd hardly know I was there.
She wanted to be on the spot. She wanted to be able to walk into her daughter's room and just say, no, I don't think that's the way to do it. I think you should do it that way. Queen Mother knew how monarchy should be run. Philip thought that it was time for a change. And the piggy in the middle is the Queen.
Since girlhood, Elizabeth had been enthralled to her mother. Now she agreed to her request to stay in the palace. This was bad news for Philip. The Queen Mother had always been suspicious of Philip's family's German origins.
The Queen Mother said quite specifically that he was a Hun. He was somebody who was rough and overbearing.
After the abdication in 1936, the Queen Mother's husband, George VI, had taken his brother's discarded crown. She believed saving the Windsor dynasty had driven him to an early grave. And she was determined this trauma would not be belittled by the eradication of the Windsor name. Backing her to the hilt was her mother-in-law, the steely-eyed Queen Mary. She was the widow of George V, the man who had created the Windsor dynasty.
Queen Mary is still a wonderfully conservative matriarch. She's really at the centre of it, like a sort of medieval queen.
Queen Mary remarked at the time, you know, what does that damn fool Edinburgh think that the family name has got to do with him?
Together, these two women formed a matriarchy that dominated the royal family. And they expected the new queen to toe the line. They had the support of the most powerful man in the land, the Conservative Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, another deep-seated traditionalist who was suspicious of Philip.
Churchill was hostile to him. He remarked privately that he neither liked nor trusted Prince Philip.
On the 18th of February 1952, Churchill's cabinet discussed the issue in 10 Downing Street, as recorded in their minutes.
The cabinet was strongly of the opinion that the family name of Windsor should be retained, and they invited the Prime Minister to take a suitable opportunity of making their views known to Her Majesty.
Churchill passed on the message, making it clear to the Queen that the government opposed Philip.
Churchill, Queen Mary, and Queen Elizabeth, all of whom understood the magic of the Windsor name, completely ganged up on Philip and said, no, this is not the way it's going to be. Windsor is the surname, and that's the way you are going to keep it.
They don't want change. They see monarchy as being something which really has to rely on what's happened in the past.
Behind closed doors, the row put pressure on Philip and the young queen.
Prince Philip would have been telling her, my name has got to be involved, because otherwise he felt sort of emasculated. He felt being sort of pushed to one side.
Barely 6 weeks into the job, Elizabeth hit the first crisis of her reign. Would she back the Windsor dynasty or her husband? On the 9th of April, 1952, she made her decision.
The Queen today declared in council her will and pleasure that she and her children shall be styled and known as the House and Family of Windsor, and that her descendants, other than female descendants who marry and their descendants, shall bear the name of Windsor.
That hurt Prince Philip deeply. You know, as we all know, he said, "I'm just a bloody amoeba."
To put the matter absolutely bluntly, he was regarded as the producer of the Queen's children, and that was about as far as he was allowed to go.
Outwardly calm, Philip revealed his bitter frustration to his friends, saying, "I am the only man in the country not allowed to give his name to his children."
He'd already given up everything else. He'd given up his freedom, he'd given up his naval career, but I think for a time it was very difficult.
For Philip and Elizabeth, tensions now simmered, but they were about to get worse. Within 4 weeks of the surname announcement, the royal couple moved into their new home, Buckingham Palace.
Philip arrived at a court which had barely changed since the time of Queen Victoria. It was extraordinarily elaborate, ceremonial and protocol, that he found intensely irritating.
There were footmen still powdering their heads with what Philip, quite reasonably, considered an unhygienic mixture of, you know, flour and water, a very archaic practice.
Defeated over the surname, Philip now found another way to assert himself. He decided to modernize Buckingham Palace. He began with a visit to every room in the palace, questioning staff to find out what they did.
He wanted to do away with a lot of the, as he saw it, unnecessary and time-wasting things. So he would carry his own suitcases. When electric frying pans came on the market, he would fry his own breakfast until the Queen complained that the smell had lingered until lunchtime.
But it would take more than an electric frying pan to change the old guard at Buckingham Palace.
Philip wanted a role, and the courtiers were determined not to let him have a role, and consequently he went round like a squirrel in a cage, you know, busy doing nothing all the time.
The problem was that Prince Philip is one man wanting everything to change, and he's surrounded by all these flunkies who want everything to stay the same.
Under Admiralty Arch, into Trafalgar Square, the tumult of welcome and love surrounds her. From the packed pavements and the windows and the roofs above. In a welcome of bells, the Queen arrives at Westminster.
In June 1953, Philip's role as supporting actor was confirmed to the world. Millions watched as Queen Elizabeth II was crowned. The first to kneel before her was her husband.
I, Philip, will become your liege man of life and limb, and of earthly worship. In faith and truth I will bear unto you to live and die against all manner of folk, so help me God.
I think Philip is caged by the role that fate has given him, which is to be an attendant to the Queen. He meant to be his own man and create his own world and be on his own terms, somebody who did something.
Philip yearned for a project of his own. Fortunately, one was at hand.
I name the ship Britannia. I wish success to her and to all who sail in her.
Her Majesty releases the traditional bottle, not of champagne this time, but of Empire wine.
On the 16th of April, 1953, at Clydeside in Scotland, the Queen had launched the new royal yacht. Philip seized control of the design of the still unfinished ship. He brought in modernist architect Hugh Casson to oversee the project. As Casson's designs show, instead of chandeliers and velvet, the result reflected Philip's own modernizing character. In the finished ship, Philip's bedroom looked like a senior naval officer's Spartan quarters. But one small detail of Philip's study gives a revealing window into his state of mind. In Pride of Place was a scale model of HMS Magpie, the naval ship whose command he'd been forced to give up.
There it was, staring him in the face, a poignant reminder of the naval career that he might have had. He was in charge of this lovely toy boat, but it really was a toy boat. It wasn't a real naval vessel of the kind that he aspired to command. So it emphasized the emptiness of his position.
Philip didn't even get to sail on Britannia's maiden voyage. He had to accompany his wife on a Commonwealth tour. In May 1954, he finally joined the ship as it sailed from Libya to Malta. Yet the trip had echoes of the career Philip had been forced to abandon. The Britannia was joined by the Royal Navy, the fighting force the young Philip had been tipped to command. It then docked in Malta, the very island where he had aimed at high naval office.
It remained something that he always looked back on with a certain amount of regret.
Desperate for a role of his own, soon Philip would use Britannia to break out of the palace. But rumours of a rift in the royal marriage would at last leak into the press. By the mid-50s, Prince Philip had achieved international fame. But privately, he'd suffered serious disappointments. And he'd been stripped of his career and his right to name his children.
Philip was expected to take this background role, this completely passive, almost domestic role.
This was a man who'd been accustomed to command, and suddenly the only responsibility he's got is to stand there looking very handsome beside the Queen.
In October 1956, Philip finally broke out. He left his wife and children and set off on a world tour aboard the Royal Yacht Britannia. Over 4 months, Philip made a leisurely crossing of the Atlantic and the Pacific, meeting some of his wife's colonial subjects. But his long absence gave rise to rumours that all was not well at home.
It didn't look as if the marriage was at its happiest. He did things like not coming back for his son's birthday. And rumours then spread of a rift. He was known to enjoy the company of male friends. Inevitably, there were rumours that not all the friends were male.
Reports swirled that there were problems in the royal marriage. In America, the Baltimore Sun reported rumours that Philip was involved with an unnamed other woman. The story appeared to be a rehash of an old piece of gossip about Philip from 8 years earlier. In 1948, Philip had allegedly spent a night on the town with a singer named Pat Kirkwood. Her legs had been described as the eighth wonder of the world. There was no evidence of an affair, but gossip about the incident fed suspicions that had dogged Philip since he was a young man.
Even before they married, George VI was concerned that Philip seemed to be a little bit of a womanizer.
You know, he'd had what someone described as armfuls of girls in his youth, and he would probably go on having armfuls of girls, albeit rather more discreetly, in his middle age.
As pressure mounted, the palace broke its usual wall of silence on royal private lives and issued a public denial.
It is quite untrue that there is any rift between the Queen and the Duke.
That was in itself perhaps a mistake, because of course there's nothing like denying a story to give it some plausibility.
Now the stories began to seep into the press back home.
The British papers dismissed the rumours as idle gossip, but that didn't stop them running the story. In February 1957, Elizabeth joined Philip in Portugal at the end of his tour.
4 months almost to the day after I left home, the Queen flew out to Portugal and we enjoyed 2 days there together.
On the 28th of February, at a lunch to mark his return to London, Philip made no mention of the stories in the press.
As you know, this adventure ended where it began, at London Airport, with a very happy family reunion.
But the publicity the trip had attracted was rather less happy. As Philip and Elizabeth had learned, the papers were growing hungrier for salacious royal stories. And in the modern world, an obedient press was a thing of the past. Two years after their marriage had hit the headlines, the royal couple had some more wholesome news to announce. A decade after the birth of Princess Anne, the Queen was expecting a third child. But the new arrival would open an old wound. The couple would have another child without Philip's surname. Philip prepared to battle the palace again, but he wouldn't be alone. On his side would be one of the most controversial British royals of the 20th century. Lord Louis Mountbatten was Philip's uncle. A former head of the British Armed Forces, Mountbatten was proud and fiercely ambitious.
Mountbatten's ambitions were boundless. Anyone who was rash enough to ignore his ambitions was likely to find themselves knocked rather savagely out of the way.
The British establishment, including the Queen Mother and the government, viewed Mountbatten with some suspicion. They believed he shared Philip's dangerous obsession with modernizing the monarchy, and that he wanted to push his minor branch of the royal family, the Mountbattens, to the very center stage. He had already coached his nephew, Philip Mountbatten, towards marriage with Princess Elizabeth. Unbowed by the earlier defeat, Mountbatten was determined the royal children should bear his and Philip's name.
Mountbatten wanted to become the head of the British royal family. It was going to be the House of Mountbatten.
So far, both his and Philip's efforts had failed. But things were about to change, thanks to the arrival of an unlikely individual. Edward Ewe was a solicitor, obsessed with the microscopic detail of British law. For decades, he'd bombarded the British establishment with corrections to the legal system.
He wrote letters to the Times, and the most maddening thing about him was that he was often right. And he maintained that it was quite wrong that the royal children should not have their father's name.
Mountbatten had found an ally. On the 10th of August 1959, Ewe and Mountbatten met to discuss the name. Ewe wrote a personal account of what happened next. Its contents have never been made public until now. As the account reveals, Ewe had a proposal. A new hyphenated royal name, Mountbatten Windsor. Ewe now kicked off the campaign. In a letter, now in the National Archives, he gave a warning to Prime Minister Harold Macmillan about the imminent royal birth.
When the new baby is born, as matters now stand, it will bear the badge of bastardy, namely, its mother's maiden name.
To raise the suggestion that somehow the royal children were illegitimate was something that really set the cat among the pigeons.
Macmillan tried to gag Ewe in a personal letter.
The highest legal authorities hold the opinion that your points are not well founded, and I should be most grateful if you would refrain from reiterating them in public. I'm sure I can rely on your discretion.
Ewe refused to be silenced. but he knew he needed a respected public figure on his side. So he asked a favour from an old friend.
Edward Ewe managed to mobilise a bishop who rejoiced in the name of Bishop Bloomer of Carlisle to preach a sermon about the delegitimising, as it were, of the royals.
Bishop Bloomer's sermon, supporting the new name, was reported in the Times.
He did not like to think of any child born in wedlock being deprived of the father's family name, a right and privilege which every other legitimate child in the land possesses.
As the issue spread into the public domain, the debate intensified within the walls of Buckingham Palace. According to Macmillan, Philip put pressure on his wife over the name, as he confided to his diary.
What upsets me is the prince's almost brutal attitude to the queen over all this.
A source close to the deputy prime minister, Rab Butler, said Butler had claimed discussion of the name had reduced the queen to tears. In February 1960, Elizabeth once again faced a choice between the man who had given up so much for her sake and the dynasty to which she was devoted. 11 days before the birth of the baby, the Queen issued a statement, creating a new family name. Mountbatten Windsor.
It is the House of Windsor. Nothing can change that. That's Parliament. They decide that. But they as a family are Mountbatten Windsor.
It certainly was a victory for Philip. It was something which he had wanted and had sought after actively for a long time, and at last had achieved.
Ewe's handwritten account has one final revelation, unknown to historians before now. The day after the Queen's statement, he was invited to Mountbatten's house. At his host's request, he slipped in through a side door to escape attention. There, Ewe had a drink with Mountbatten and Prince Philip. Yet if Philip had won one battle, he soon had another struggle on his hands. The surname was announced just 5 weeks into a brand new decade.
The 1960s saw a complete seismic change in the social attitudes and expectations of everything. I mean, fashion, music, women's position, and of course the royal family were not left untouched.
In these rapidly changing times, tradition was under attack. Encased in privilege, the Windsors were vulnerable.
There was definitely this impression that Britain had become a very closed, backward-looking society, run by public schoolboys who knew nothing at all about the modern world. And the monarchy was seen as being at the apex of that.
The monarchy should be abolished.
The monarchy should be abolished. What makes you say that?
Well, what good are they?
In November 1966, the BBC investigated public attitudes towards the royal family. Among the happy flag-waving, a growing restlessness was revealed.
You've got the Queen, the Duke of Edinburgh, you've got the rest of them. They're taking the public's money, aren't they? That's what I feel about it.
I think that she should get out and meet the people more instead of meeting all these social occasions, meet the common people.
Yes.
90% want the monarchy to stay, but only 1 in 4 think it should continue as it is now. The great majority, 64%, think it should change with the times.
A changing Britain demanded a changing monarchy. Sensing his moment, Philip was about to seize the reins. Soon he would reboot the royal family for the modern age, but open it up to new dangers.
Queen Elizabeth II leaves Buckingham Palace for the most spectacular event of the royal year.
On Saturday, the 13th of June, 1964, the Windsors put on one of their world-famous pageants. A regular event since the early 19th century, trooping the colour was an unchanging ritual. But away from the parade ground, Britain was changing very fast. 8 weeks earlier, the Rolling Stones had released their first album. The previous autumn, Labour leader Harold Wilson had praised a new Britain driven by the white heat of science and technology. Then, in October 1964, Labour swept the Conservatives from power.
Harold Wilson had become Prime Minister, and there was a greater equality in the air, or at least the thought of equality in the air.
For the Windsors, the ancient rituals that had once been their strength were starting to look like a straitjacket.
The royal family is beginning to feel different from some spirit that's moving through Britain.
But there was one exception.
In the 1950s, Philip is very much a lone voice, calling for modernisation and being blocked and shut down whenever he tries to do anything. But by the 1960s, Philip is in tune with the times, and change is in the air, and Philip is behind change.
Philip now began a one-man global campaign to give the Windsors a new, modern face.
Prince Philip is a modern man, and he's into modern things, setting out to identify himself with modern scientific and industrial British achievements.
He was good looking, he was tall, he liked gadgets. He was almost like a kind of domesticated royal James Bond. James Bond, of course, is a commander in the Royal Navy. He likes gadgets, he likes girls. Prince Philip is absolutely cut from that cloth.
Philip believed the royal family needed to re-engage with a rapidly changing modern Britain. One medium, above all, gave the opportunity. By the 60s, TV was the dominant means of mass communication. Philip had spotted the power of television early. The Radio Times, from the 30th of June 1957, showed a suave Philip on a futuristic set, making his presenting debut in a science documentary.
The International Geophysical Year begins at midnight. The great adventure is about to start.
Prince Philip is beautiful, elegant, scientific, modernizing, in charge.
Radio engineers aim their transmissions in such a way that it bounces off this ionized layer back to the receiving station, rather like a billiard ball bounces off a cushion into a pocket.
He's instinctively and accurately reaching out for the most important propaganda tool of the moment.
Philip believed TV could restore something essential to the survival of the royal family. Since the foundation of the dynasty in 1917, the Windsors had forged a close relationship with the people. From George V's informal visits to working-class areas, to George VI and the Queen Mother's walkabouts during the Blitz. Yet in recent years, the Windsors seem to have lost their common touch.
If they don't seem to be approachable, if they don't seem to be human, if they seem to be little tin gods, then they are remote from the people and they cannot expect the same degree of affection.
Philip thought the royal family needed to reconnect with the people of Britain. As he explained in a revealing interview in 1968.
Well, instead of endlessly having to fend off a too closer scrutiny in an attempt to try and live a normal life, it is now possible not to go to the offensive, but to try and make contact and try and create a kind of two-way relationship.
He had been pressing for years for the monarchy to be more dynamic in the way it presented itself to the nation, particularly with the advent of telly. He recognised, you know, they couldn't stay in their kind of gilded tower forever, that they had to get out and communicate with the public.
Now Philip got his chance. Lord Mountbatten's son-in-law, John Brabourne, was a TV producer. In 1968, he asked Philip if he could make a fly-on-the-wall documentary about the royal family. Inspired, Philip championed the film inside the palace and chaired the committee to set up to explore the idea. Yet the idea of behind-the-scenes access flew in the face of palace tradition.
The Buckingham Palace flunkies were worried that people would lose respect if they saw the members of the royal family purely as TV characters, as characters in a kind of soap opera, that once you invited the cameras in, they would be hungry for more.
16 years after Prince Philip had first tried to modernize the royal family, the battle was on again.
There was the conflict, two visions of monarchy. Stay as you are, look backwards, do what you've done well in the past. And the other vision of monarchy, which is adapt and change, because if you don't, you die.
Yet by 1968, things had changed. The Queen Mother was 68 years old, and her power in the palace was fading. Queen Mary had died, weakening the great Windsor matriarchy. And their ally, Churchill, had passed away in 1965. Meanwhile, Philip's power within the palace was growing, and his vision had caught the spirit of Britain. The decision fell to the Queen. As a young woman, she had obeyed her elders. This time, she supported her husband. In the summer of 1968, for the first time, cameras moved into Buckingham Palace to film intimate footage of the Windsors. Then, on the 21st of June 1969, Britain tuned in to watch history being made.
He did have some very strange habits, my father. I remember when I used to come up to Royal Lodge, I asked when I arrived, and I said, where's the king? And they said, oh, he's in the garden. Yeah. And I went out and there's nothing to be seen except a lot of terribly rude words and language coming out of a rhododendron bush. So I eventually found him there hacking away. Wearing a bearskin cap,
As the footage shows, Philip came across as a relaxed family man.
I think what was particularly groundbreaking was to present the royal family as a family, i.e. the accent is on the word family rather than on the word royal.
The salad is ready.
Good.
The very fact of the royal family cooking on a barbecue seemed to some people absolutely jaw-dropping. You know, they'd assumed, I think, that sort of footmen in wigs would present them with sausages on a silver platter or something.
I watched it, I think, with my parents, and there was that electric buzz of a direct connection to something you hadn't seen before. And relationships emerge. You see a real relationship, actually, to the little children.
This is what he really would like. Yeah, she'll go straight for the ice cream. Yes. So, well, would you like to go and get some? Just
change, this is all I want.
Thank you.
Disgusting,
just dewy mist,
he's
going to be in the car,
isn't he? 2/3 watched the film.
Everybody said, oh, this is a terrific, pioneering, brilliant stroke by the palace because it's enabling the Queen's people to see her and her family as they are in the late 20th century. So it was a brilliant piece of public relations.
The documentary's triumph completed the transformation of Prince Philip from downtrodden outsider to the Windsor's driving force.
Philip's influence in changing the monarchy was absolutely crucial. He throws up all sorts of ideas. He creates a kind of atmosphere of change, of radicalization.
For the young man once tipped for the very top of the Navy, there had been a personal cost.
With almost no exceptions, anybody who marries into the royal family sees their identity taken from them.
But Philip had forged a new identity. Battling the conservative palace and rebooting the royal family.
Every so often it is vital that there should be a driving force, a reforming force within the establishment. And that, at that moment, was exactly what Prince Philip provided.
Yet despite his modernizing energy, there was one thing Prince Philip didn't foresee. The Royal Family documentary was to have a sting in the tail.
Publicity is a two-edged sword. If they could produce this, what amounted to a huge royal commercial, then it was legitimate to use the media as a means of criticizing the royal family when they didn't measure up in whatever way.
I think the problem that they faced, the royals, once they did that royal family documentary, why stop there? You know, once you've let them in once, why can't you always let them in? And from that moment, really, they become fair game, I think, for the tabloids in a way that they never had quite been before.
The film was withdrawn from public view and hasn't been seen in its entirety since. But in the decades that followed, the intimate glimpses it had provided fed a hunger for more and more personal royal revelations.
They had opened the Pandora's box, opened themselves up into criticism. You might well date the emergence of a much more critical press to the showing of that film.
The Windsors had been rebranded for the modern media age. But in the years to come, there would be a price to pay. The British people had seen the royal family in their off-duty clothes. Soon, they wanted the dirty laundry. Next time, new revelations about Prince Charles's love life expose a man desperate to find his perfect bride. The ambitious Mountbatten steps in as the royal matchmaker, but a brutal terrorist murder pushes Charles towards a hasty decision.
9 o'clock tomorrow night, where the other half rest on a visit to the capital, a very British hotel. Morgan Freeman wants an ensuite. Of course he does. 10 o'clock straight after, Break the Stereotype. Young British Muslims letting you in their hopes, their dreams, their worries growing up in modern Britain.